My name is Steve Edwards. I'm the executive director of the Institute of Politics here at the University of Chicago. And it's our great pleasure to be collaborating with the Harris School and especially the Paulson Institute, our next door neighbors here on campus, for this conversation, which is such a critical one as we think about the future of U.S. foreign policy with the new administration, as we think about the long arc of relationships with our neighbors in China. It's oddly, I think, stark that we haven't had a lot of conversation in this campaign about the intricacies of that relationship. Beyond just a bit about trade policy, there's so much that has been largely absent from the dialogue. So we're greatly pleased to be able to dig into the nuances of that relationship in greater detail here. A quick point about logistics. As we always do at events here, we will create time for you to pose questions to our guests and our panelists. We ask that when you do, you make it a question, and you keep it short and to the point so that we get to as many of you as possible. So without further ado, I'm going to turn the floor over to Evan Feigenbaum, who is the vice chair of the Paulson Institute. Evan knows this world as well as anybody. He spent 8 years in the State Department with a broad portfolio over Asia, South Asia, and previously received a PhD in Chinese studies at Stanford. So he is well suited to lead us off and continue the dialogue. So please join me in welcoming Evan. Evan, thanks so much.
All right. Well, hi, everybody. First, let me thank Steve. I see a lot of new faces. So I should just say at the beginning, we do this as a monthly contemporary China series, the Paulson Institute, on campus, because we're a China-focused institute. We do kind of monthly, we do it in partnership with the Harris School. We've done the economy of China, politics, society, sometimes arts and culture, and we encourage you to, those of you who are new faces, to keep up with the series and keep on coming. But this is the first time we've done it with the Institute of Politics, and we couldn't be happier about it. You're our neighbors, as I said. So thanks to Steve, to Alicia, to David. We really appreciate it. And we're excited to do this program. And I'm particularly excited because I get to have two of my favorite people and great friends and former government colleague, but former colleagues here in Chicago with us. We're 4 days out from a presidential election where the next president's going to face a whole variety of foreign policy challenges. But I personally, not just because I'm so focused on Asia, but more generally, would argue that China is going to be one of the most interesting and toughest challenges the next president's going to face. And so we thought, you know, what would be better than to have the top dedicated Asia advisors to the last two presidents of the United States, President Obama in Jeff's case, President George W. Bush in Dennis's case, come talk about what's at stake. What's at stake with China, the kinds of choices the next president's going to have to make, what are the assumptions, the presumptions that they need to bring or shed, and then operationally, how do you do China well as an American foreign policymaker. These guys are incredibly experienced, both of them decades of government experience. In Dennis's case in the CIA, but then also at the National Security Council, and Jeff's at the State Department, the US Trade Representative, and then at the National Security Council. What we're gonna do, we'll have kind of a casual conversation up here for a little while, and then we'll do it. We usually do this pretty casually, so we'll open it up and give you a shot at these guys too. So, I'm based in Chicago, but I spend a lot of time going to Washington, and I find when you sit at conferences or events on China in Washington these days, people keep throwing out this phrase that I hear a lot, and it's that there was an establishment consensus, whatever that means, on how the United States should develop policy toward China. Mm-hmm. And people say that consensus, such as it was, has begun to fray. And some people would argue, oh, it's collapsing. We need a wholesale change in the way we approach China. So whenever I hear that, it gets me thinking about, first, was there a consensus, and what was there a consensus on? And then second, whether the premises that we've brought to American interaction with China for the last 20, 30 years still apply. And to make that real for you, let me throw out a couple of things that I sometimes hear. First, that economic integration between the United States and China would mitigate national security-related competition. particularly in Asia. The more intertwined our economies became, the less we need to worry about security competition, right? But I mean, the US and China have never been more economically integrated than they are today. $600 billion in trade, $50 billion in US FDI stock in China, all of this Chinese investment now flowing to the United States. And yet, at least superficially, but I actually think quite substantively, it looks like the United States and China really have some clashing security concepts, diverging interests, and security competition not only is not going away, it's intensifying. All right, another premise. If we have common interests, we will necessarily develop complementary approaches or policies. But the United States and China have a lot of common interests. Nobody wants a nuclear North Korea, a nuclear Iran. Of course, we want a stable and growing world economy. But on so many of these issues, we don't seem to be able to get to really robust U.S.-China cooperation. So why is that? Well, maybe it's because the common interests are shared at a relatively high level of abstraction. Peace, security, stability, development. But when you try to get from shared interests at point A to cooperative policies at point P, you have to work your way through a whole series of other issues. Countervailing interests that come into play, diverging assessments of the scope, the urgency of a threat from North Korea, for instance, different hierarchy of priorities. Then there's the more global nature of the U.S.-China relationship. As we went more global, we're working together maybe in Africa, Central Asia, Latin America. Does that create another dimension that mitigates the security competition in East Asia in particular? So I've heard premises like this asserted for a long time, but I think there's a case to be made that they've turned out either to be flawed at best, false at worst, or that things are not playing out the way the simplest explanations of U.S.-China relations predicted that they might be. So maybe we can start there and take a shot at any of that, or at the idea of a conceptual architecture to the U.S.-China relationship that has guided this for a while but may or may not be relevant anymore. And I'm thinking maybe we start with Dennis, and then, or we can start with you guys. All right, let's start with Jeff.
I think that there was a relative consensus on approach to China until recent years. I think that consensus is fraying. I think now there is a common view that we're dealing with a China that is going in different directions than the China that we've been dealing with since the Nixon years. I think that that's a misguided view in some ways. I think that really what we're dealing with is a China that has vastly different capacities, vastly different capabilities, economically, politically, and militarily, than the China that we were talking about in 2001 when they were admitted to the WTO. From the 1980s and through WTO, our approach to China was essentially integration of China into the global system on which we had written the rules, and we were the gatekeeper. And there was a common consensus that as China joins the international community, including the WTO, they will become, in some sense, more like us, and that rivalry will be muted as a result. I think that there was a lot that was incomplete about that particular view. But on the other hand, I wouldn't completely dismiss the notion that economic integration has mitigated strategic rivalry. Certainly there is strategic rivalry, there is security rivalry, and that I view as kind of a natural thing. It's a function of a rising power encountering a dominant power, and it's a function of China's different history, different culture, different ideology, different political system, and its particular interests in Asia, which are in Asia in particular, more so than globally, that are different than ours. But still, if you take a comparison with the other great power in the world, Russia, and you look at U.S.-Russia relations and compare it with U.S.-China relations, I think what you'll see is that the economic interdependence between the U.S. and China has produced a different kind of relationship than the relationship between U.S. and Russia. Russia is not really integrated in a serious way into the global economy. It's still basically an energy country whose economy has been in semi-free fall for the last couple of years with the decline in energy prices. It's hard to see much common interest or much commonality in the U.S.-Russia relationship right now. It's basically nothing but strategic rubber right now. Whereas in the case of China, there are all kinds of issues where we cooperate, all kinds of mechanisms for muting strategic rivalry. I think that people do not feel that the risk of a military clash between the U.S. and China is substantial in the foreseeable future, whereas I think people feel much less confident about the U.S.-Russia relationship in that respect. And I won't say that's entirely because of economic integration, but I think economic integration is a big part of that. The Chinese leadership understands that, to use Bob Zelick's phrase, you know, that maybe they aren't a completely responsible stakeholder, but they are a stakeholder in the global system. And to the extent that they have conflicts with their neighbors or conflicts with the United States, they will suffer the consequences. I think Russia feels much less invested in that notion. So I don't know that to the extent that notion that you threw out was relevant in 2001, I'm not sure it's irrelevant now.
Dennis, you agree with that?
Yeah, I'd say several things. One is Washington is struggling with a bigger issue that China is part of, which is this challenge to the notion that globalization is good. I just ran a conference in Washington at Georgetown on this subject, and it's very interesting. Globalization has changed so dramatically how corporations operate, how the world economic system operates, that it's very hard to understand anymore for people. And I think for the average American, and we see it in the Trump campaign, there is a feeling that they've been sold a bill of goods, that they were told that globalization would be good for them. And what they see is that globalization has some real downsides from their vantage point. Now, their analysis may be wrong. It may not be that their jobs went to China. It may be that robotics took over and those jobs disappeared because factory jobs just aren't what they used to be in the United States. Nonetheless, there is this perception that the jobs went to China. So the consensus on free trade, I think, has frayed in this country badly. And a new president's going to have to figure out how to bring that consensus back, assuming, as I do, that free trade is good for the American people. It's just that the benefits have not been shared equitably in American society. Second point I would make is that China has changed in a way that has unsettled Washington. Xi Jinping is a very different kind of leader from Hu Jintao. Hu Jintao was a very quiet, frankly, meek man. Xi Jinping is an assertive man. And China has new capabilities. And from his point of view, China should be part of setting the rules, setting the global rules. Now, 10 years ago, that would not have been part of the Chinese plan. When they entered the WTO, they had to play by our rules. That was how we put it. Now the Chinese are sort of saying, wait a minute, we've become the second largest power in the world, second largest economy, and we may become the largest. So shouldn't we be part of the ruling authority of the world? And I think that's uncomfortable for Washington. I think people in Washington are not used to being challenged that way in East Asia. So I think that there is a lot of complexity. One of the things Colin Powell used to say is there's no bumper sticker in U.S.-China relations. There is no simple way to explain it. Because while we're talking about all these problems, I can also point to you a bunch of areas where we're doing very well with China. The climate change agreement is a huge positive in the relationship. We are cooperating off the coast of Somalia. American Navy and Chinese Navy cooperate on the high seas in that area of the world. As China goes global, China's going to need us more and more in certain areas of the world. We will have to work together on counterterrorism as China now has people in the Middle East, in places like Afghanistan, Pakistan, Libya, you name it. There's much more cooperation that needs to occur on the counterterrorism side. So this is a very mixed picture when you deal with China. There's no simple answers.
So picking up on that, let's talk about how you get consensus with China on things that the United States cares about. We did an event downtown this morning, and somebody in the audience asked this incredibly stark question. They said, essentially, you know, China is what China is, and China's gonna, I'm paraphrasing, but China is what China is, and the Chinese are gonna do what's in their self-interest, and we just gotta deal with that as it is, and we're gonna have to bump it and pursue our interests in a completely self-interested way. All of which I think is incontestable. Of course, we should pursue our interest in a self-interested way. And China will too. But if you're trying to get to consensus, it begs the question of how you can affect or not the choices of the counterparty in a negotiation or a discussion. Right? Because if you can't shape their choices at all, then you can either pack it up and go home. That's option one. Option two, you only try to work in areas where you already have agreement. So things that are easy, you would never do the hard stuff. Or the third option is you work around them and you try to, I guess, shape the environment, you work with other partners, confront them with a set of opportunities and choices that shape their choices or behavior, influence their conduct. So from your experience trying to, and make it real, pick out two or three issues or one issue that you worked on in the U.S.-China relationship. And talk a little bit, and don't pick an easy one where the U.S. and China already agreed on everything. Something where, kind of picking up on the way I asked the earlier question, we had a common interest, but it wasn't easy because there were other things that were in there. How do you get to agreement with China as an American policymaker or bureaucrat on something that isn't just straightforward and easy?
Okay, let me try three of them. Cyber hacking, Iran nuclear, and climate change. I think they're, because they're three different cases with three different solutions, three different sets of methods that we use. I think the common denominator of all of them is you need to have a good working relationship at the top between President Obama or whoever the President of the United States is and President Xi Jinping. Some people say that, well, China's going to pursue its interests and we're going to pursue our interests. That's all true. That's a cliche. But when you're negotiating a difficult issue, if the other side has basic fundamental distrust of your motives and a sense that you wish them ill, that you feel that they're, that your relationship is a purely competitive relationship, it's one of rivalry, they're not going to deal. And they're not certainly not going to meet you more than halfway or halfway. So you need to have a personal relationship at the top of some degree of openness and transparency and confidence, and you need to have a sense in the overall relationship that we do not wish you ill. Okay? We do not seek to contain you. We're not trying to take down your system. If you don't have that, you're not going to get anywhere. Okay, now take these three. Cyber, Xi Jinping was coming to the United States. The U.S. had been examining a number of cases where the Chinese security ministries were involved in espionage aimed at American companies, stealing intellectual property. The U.S. was preparing to sanction Chinese companies that were the beneficiaries of that espionage, and that word leaked, deliberately or not deliberately. Deliberately, most likely. This was the number one issue on the Hill at the time. This was the hottest political issue in the United States at the time. And I think Xi Jinping became convinced that A, we were going to sanction some companies, and B, his trip was going to be ruined. The major trip to the United States, which Mr. Paulson was very instrumental in on the West Coast portion. He dispatched his number one security official, much to the surprise of all of us, to the United States to negotiate an agreement on the eve of the visit. Okay? And astonishingly to me, and I think astonishingly to most people, they reached an agreement, which has fundamentally changed Chinese behavior towards intellectual property theft. Not towards espionage, which they're doing just as much as ever, and we're doing just as much as ever, but specifically towards corporate intellectual property. Okay? I think in that case, clearly the threat of sanctions was credible, was effective, was important, and the timing of Xi Jinping's visit, that's one. Iran, from the beginning of the Obama administration, I took a trip to Iran. I took a trip to China.
That would have been
with that was Ollie North who did that. But I took a trip to China with Dennis Ross in October of 2009. And basically, it was before President Obama met with Hu Jintao. And what we were communicating to the Chinese was that this was the number one national security issue for the United States. This is number one. There are a lot of other issues. They're all important. This is number one. This is the one that President Obama cares the most about. And so you want a good relationship with us. This is the one you got to think about, because we didn't use the phrase core interest, but in their terms, this was core interest to the U.S. Okay? And we impressed upon them how fast this issue was moving in the wrong direction, that the clocks were all working the wrong way, that nuclear proliferation in the Middle East, in Saudi Arabia, potentially in Japan at some point, and the future of the non-proliferation treaty were at stake if we didn't deal with the Iran issue effectively. The Chinese, I think in this case, substantially brought into our strategic argument about the risks of nuclear proliferation in the Middle East spreading to East Asia to their detriment. Plus, they were impressed that this was our number one issue. And so they joined with us in the negotiations to freeze Iran's nuclear program. In the case of climate change, in that case, the dominant factor, I went to Copenhagen with President Obama and Secretary Clinton in 2009, and it was kind of a catastrophic event in many respects. And the Chinese were completely unpersuaded at that time because they had to do anything on climate. It's an American problem, it's a European problem, it's not our problem. We're not part of the solution, and we don't care. We sort of believe the science, but so on. But over the next couple of years, largely because of domestic political factors in China, they moved. The issue of the environment in China became arguably the most sensitive and the most, unsettling issue for the leadership with the Chinese population in major cities. And of course, the steps that you have to take to deal with air pollution in most cases is pretty much the same as the steps you've been taking in climate change. So the Chinese reached the conclusion that this was, Chinese leadership reached the conclusion that this was in their political domestic interest, and that therefore they should take a much more forthcoming approach. So I think there are three different issues, three different sets of incentives, disincentives. They all came out well. Common denominator was, as I say, intensive interaction between our two presidents and trying to establish some degree of openness and trust in the dialogue between them.
So before I go to this, let me just push you. So on the Iran example, for instance, the ask of the Chinese was that they send a parallel message to the Iranians, essentially, that it was in China's interest, and not to carry water for the, not that the Americans cared, but that China would send a complimentary and parallel message to the Iranians about what China cared about, and they were responsible.
That's correct, and but candidly, we spoke to a number of other regional countries that China cared about. One large country in the Gulf that produces a lot of oil, specifically, that has a very important relationship with China, and which has a very, very hostile relationship with Iran. And we spoke a lot to that country, and they communicated very, very clearly to the Chinese that it would have profound consequences for their supposed strategic partnership that they were developing and the kinds of investments that they were in the process of developing in China if the Chinese were not sensitive to their concerns about Iran.
Yeah, so there's a profound lesson in that, because I had a couple of issues I worked on. In nearby but different region, where you know, the Chinese actually were quite responsive to what the United States had to say, but frequently when they would deliver the messages to the party, it was along the lines of the Americans care deeply about X, Y, and Z. Mm-hmm. And what we needed was not them to carry American water, but a complementary and parallel message about what China cares about.
Absolutely.
And I think that really gets at the very center of this question of how do you work with China. Getting China from this point to that point is really an essential ingredient of success on some of these efforts.
Yeah, it doesn't get anywhere to have the Canadians or someone going and say the Americans are supposed to say the following.
Yeah.
It doesn't get anywhere.
Especially the Canadians. Sorry, it's already connected. All right, Dennis, pick an issue or two.
Okay. I'm going to do this from a little different angle. I agree with everything Jeff said, but I think that one of the things that Americans are very poor at most of the time is understanding that you have to develop the trust and personal relationships to get there with the Chinese leadership. And let me take an example from Secretary Paulson. President Bush brought Secretary Paulson in and had to convince him to come in. He was a reluctant Secretary of the Treasury at first because we couldn't get anywhere on the economic issues with the Chinese. And it was becoming a huge problem with Capitol Hill. There were all kinds of bills about the renminbi, the devaluation. All of these subjects were very heated. What Secretary Paulson did that was so impressive was he created what was called the Strategic Economic Dialogue. And he took the time to go over and get to know people. The Chinese government gave him as a counterpart a woman named Madame Wu Yi, called the Iron Lady of China. And I think she is the Iron Lady of China. She was a tough, tough negotiator. But Hank won her over. And Hank built the kind of relationship that made it possible to make forward movement. Then when Wu Yi retired, they gave him Wang Jishan as his counterpart. Well, you all know who Wang Jishan is today, arguably the second most powerful man in China. And if you read Hank's book, you will see that he credits that relationship with helping to keep us from a Great Depression. And so I think that one of the things I'm trying to say to whatever administration comes in is build these relationships. Have people at the cabinet level willing to invest the time and energy. It's difficult. You have the tyranny of distance. It takes 2 days just to get to and from China for a cabinet member. And then you have the time on the ground. And they are often very reluctant to take so much time, particularly when you say, don't go over there and negotiate something. Just get to know the other people. And they'll look at you like, I'm going to go, you know, all that way just to get to know somebody. But that is critical. The second one I want to highlight is Taiwan. As you may recall, in the Bush administration, we had to deal with Chen Shui-bian as the president of Taiwan. Chen Shui-bian clearly was a man who wanted to push as far as he could on separating Taiwan from the mainland. I won't use the word independence because we never got to that point, thank God. But he certainly wanted to create distance. And Beijing was really upset about this and thought that we might conspire with him. And one of the things President Bush did was he was very, very candid with the Chinese leadership. And we developed this phrase about no change by either side to the status quo. And we stuck with that. And every time a Chinese came in and got upset about Taiwan, the president would simply say, do you want me to reiterate my position that there will be no change to the status quo? Because if you want me to reiterate it, I'm happy to do it every time, and I will say it exactly the same way today, tomorrow, and 2 years from now. That created trust. Even though they didn't like where we were on Taiwan, we reassured them, as well as saying to them, and you better not do anything to make this worse. So we reassured and deterred, and it was extremely effective.
Consistency.
Consistency and candor. Don't try and out-polite the Chinese. I don't know how many times I have seen Americans go into the Great Hall of the People and think that they've got to act like Chinese in order to deal with Chinese. And what they do is they look like hypocrites because they sit there and agree with every word the Chinese says, and then they go home and do policy the way they want to do it. You can't do that. Go to China and be Americans. And that doesn't mean, you know, you have to be rude, but you can, but you have. Oh, it does mean you have to be rude. I'm digging a hole, so I'll let Jeff talk.
You go and there'd be senior level toasts, you know, you do a toast in diplomatic parlance, it's more substantive than raising a glass, you make a somewhat political statement. And the Chinese would do a toast and they would quote some Tang Dynasty Chinese poet, you know, the moon is far and the sun is near. but there was war between us. And then the American would do a toast and they would quote some Tang Dynasty.
Exactly.
It's pretty crazy. Yeah. Why did they call Thomas Jefferson?
Yeah. They would ask us to go find, you know. I don't know how many times they said, you know, can you find me something good in Chinese I can use? Yeah. Like Chinese.
But didn't one Jiabao pull a fast one? Didn't he quote Lincoln at one point, pull the fast one and turn it around and quote the American?
Maybe. Certainly John Zemin could recite the Gettysburg
Address.
Drop of a hat. He was good at that.
So let me ask a slightly cheeky question. So you... So you've seen, I mean, you guys, 30 years each on U.S.-China relations. So you've seen all these leaders of China, either analytically or watching them in a room, and then quite a few American presidents, including advising them directly. What do you think American presidents, not specific, but sort of generically, I'm not even asking about presidents, what do American policymakers not get about China consistently? Like, things about China that are, not because they're too complicated, but just because policy is about driving down. What are we missing about China? And what are Chinese frequently missing about the United States? Either the policy process, or the politics of the China relationship, or things that just complicate things that we're talking past each other, because people don't get it.
Well, one that Jeff raised this morning, which I think is a very good one, so I'll steal it, is that a Chinese leader operates in a system where he has to respond to an awful lot of vested interests immediately. And what do I mean by this? When we used to have phone calls with the Chinese, the White House Situation Room sets it up, and you get on the phone. On the American side, and this was typical in the Obama administration as well, you may have the president, the senior director for East Asia as the note taker, and the national security advisor. Three people in the room, only one on the telephone. On the Chinese side, we could tell by the way the phone line was working that there must have been 25 to 100 drops. There were other people sitting there listening on the phone line. And so we get very frustrated, presidents get very frustrated when they go into meetings with Chinese, and they feel like the Chinese leader is showing no spontaneity. Well, it is death to a Chinese leader to show spontaneity, because everybody on the Politburo reads those notes. They know what's been said in that meeting, and if you deviate from the line, you're going to have internal problems. So I think that's one thing Americans really don't get about at the top of the Chinese system.
How about China more generally, not just the process? Or an interchange. We're missing the complexity of China somehow.
Well, I think one of the things, and it's what has led to sort of the collapse of the Washington consensus, is we really didn't want to believe they were communists anymore. That somehow we had changed. That I remember Henry Kissinger, who I have great faith in, said there are no communists left in the Communist Party. I don't think so. I think that they are still communists. That doesn't mean you can't work with them. That doesn't mean they haven't adopted market reforms. But the Communist Party is still the Communist Party. And if you try and deny its existence or pretend that they're just like us, you get yourself in trouble.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just building on what Dana said. I think of the illusions and the difficulties that the leaders I've worked with have had vis-a-vis the Chinese. Number one, it's failure to understand the Chinese system has politics and how complicated they are. Again, in the American system, the president is the leader. The president doesn't have to answer. The president says something wrong, it doesn't matter. He's the president. It becomes right by the fact of saying it. Chinese president says something wrong, he's got to answer to six other members of the Politburo Standing Committee and another 20 members of the Politburo, and he's going to have to take it back. There's a kind of a boldness built into the American system. It's rather odd that our system is a democracy and theirs is a dictatorship, but our people are more empowered. During the 2001 crisis over the American spy plane that crash landed in Hainan Island.
April 1st, 2001.
Remember?
The American ambassador then, who had been formerly head of Pacific Command, so he's a military man by background, tried to call the vice chairman, in effect, the chief of staff of China to open up a channel of communication. I saw Admiral Prier, former Ambassador Prier, 8 years later, he said he was still waiting for the hotel to call back. Okay? Because in the American system, the Chief of Naval Operations, the PACOM commander, a chairman or a vice chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, they can take initiative and they can have a conversation and not be worried that they're going to get stabbed in the back or something. Say, Chinese side, much more complicated. They're much more cautious. They're much more careful. So when Americans, leaders, go into conversations with the Chinese, they're expecting, your candid descriptions, some flexibility, some movement, and changing their positions for them to be responsive to the brilliant things we're saying. And it doesn't happen. And they're baffled. And it's not because the Chinese are dense. On the contrary, it's because of their system, which builds in this, I think, inherent conservatism and slow-moving quality to decision-making. It's not altogether unlike the Japanese system in some ways. These are consensus systems, and they don't make decisions very quickly. Yeah.
Can I add something? Because you asked about what the Chinese don't get about us. Mm. The biggest thing that I am frustrated with on the Chinese side is that they really, after years and years of all we have done to send foreign investment to China, to allow China into our markets, to build the relationship, there are still senior Chinese who believe that we want to take down the government of China. I can count on one hand the number of government officials who really wanted to take down China, and you can probably name them. And I had to work very closely with those individuals, but they were a very, very tiny subset of the American system. The vast majority of American elites know that a China that falls apart is far, far worse than a China that prospers. And I don't know how we get through the Chinese, that our goal is not in any way, shape, or form to subvert the government of China, and yet we still get the Chinese saying, well, occupy Hong Kong was an American plot. And it couldn't be further from the truth.
A lot of students here are interested in Washington and politics. I'm actually a pretty avid reader of Washington memoirs for some reason. They all have titles like, the courage to lead, the will to triumph. The leadership to courage. Yeah. So and I particularly love memoirs by former foreign policy magazine. They all turmoil and triumph, hard choices, tough
tough days. The one that sticks out for me that I recently actually flipped through again is by former Secretary of State Jim Baker. And that book is called The Politics of Diplomacy. And he titled it, he says in the introduction, very deliberately, because foreign policy, he argues, is not separable from the political context in which policymakers operate in the United States. That at the end of the day, politics enables you to do things or it gets in your way. And I mean, there are few foreign policy relationships that seem to be more caught up in domestic politics sometimes than the U.S.-China relationship. And part of that is the economics, because let's face it, we have this big trade relationship and it's not all smooth sailing. And now that investment is coming, Chinese investment is going to touch American communities in ways, people, plants, assets, in ways that just buying and selling things doesn't. But also, you know, we go through these periodic cycles on Capitol Hill and through the public debate. We're in the middle of this election campaign. Talk about the politics of the U.S.-China relationship. Is it, when you look at the campaign, is China more political than usual? Is it less political? Are you surprised there's been as much talk about China as there has been? You've seen this YouTube video where Donald Trump just says the word China over China, and now it's all going with the China. Is it a function of that? I mean, is there more China or less, and what do politics do to the ability to make China policy, either by enabling it to make it easier to actually get things done, which is, I think, what Secretary Baker meant, but also not, that you can't be ignorant of the political context in which you are.
Just a few comments. First of all, in terms of political memoirs by former officials, I highly recommend for those in this room who haven't read Hank Paulson's memoir. That's the best I've read. And I wrote my own memoir on my time in the Obama administration, and candidly, it's Hank's memoir that inspired a guiding principle of what I wrote. I remember Hank's memoir was incredibly insightful. I learned a tremendous amount, but the other thing that struck me about it was there wasn't a single page in there that was mean-spirited. He didn't, there was nothing nasty about him. I was done reading Hank, and I could tell who you really admired and who you admired less, but not because you took down anyone, okay? And I took that as, frankly, as my mom. I was not going to do a score settling, and it's because of the book you wrote. But anyway, that's an aside. Politics. My time in the Obama administration, I was very pleased by the absence of effective pressure from the Republican side or from Capitol Hill on China. I had been through the Clinton years, impeachment time, and the pressure was unbearable. In the Obama years, it was quite different. They were highly partisan years, needless to say. But on China, we by and large had a free hand. There weren't hostile hearings, there weren't hostile investigations, there weren't angry letters demanding this and that. I think there were certain issues where there were constraints. But by and large, we were able to pursue a fairly bipartisan policy without too much grandstanding, except from kind of the extremes. I've been through periods like in the Clinton years or in George H.W. Bush years where there was tremendous partisanship on China coming from outside that really crippled policymakers. I didn't experience it that much in the Obama years, and so I have not seen that much that's been crippling this campaign. I mean, if you go back, one of my sort of formative experiences in dealing with China has been some of these election year tensions. 1980, Ronald Reagan threatening to overturn normalization, the reversal of normalization between Taiwan and PRC, and threatening to sell advanced fighter aircraft to the PRC, which resulted in a torturous year and a half negotiation of what became the 1982 arms communique between the U.S. and China. In 1992, candidate Clinton, referring to the butchers of Beijing at the Democratic Convention, and leading ultimately to, you know, a very anti-China campaign run by the Democrats, which was, I think, very substantially politically driven because George H.W. Bush had been ambassador to China and was identified with China, and I think that candidate Clinton saw advantage, political advantage in this respect. And that in turn led to 2 years of dreadful relations between Washington and Beijing that took a crisis in the Taiwan Strait before we finally got over. And then I think on a lesser scale in the year 2000, candidate George W. Bush, who said we're turning away from the strategic partnership that was the policy of President Clinton's later years towards strategic competition. I think that wasn't as intense as the 1980 and 1992 difficulties, but it did create a certain tension at the beginning, which blew up in particular during the EP3 episode over Hainan, and then President Bush basically arbitrated between factions in this administration and decided that he was going to be an engagement president on China rather than the four or five people that Dennis mentioned. So those were intensely political presidential campaigns where there were tremendous pressures on the relationship. Now, this campaign, this hasn't been a terribly substantive campaign on any issue. And on China, it's mostly economic. There hasn't been that much security discussion in the campaign. And the economic discussion has mostly been about jobs and trade, and I think China underlies it, but you haven't heard much serious discussion about what China's role in it is. It's what Dennis was saying in his opening comments about the mood, particularly in rural areas or in factory towns, about people's plight and associating China with it. But it's not so much about what should we do about China policy. So I guess I'm not deeply concerned about whether the campaign is going to constrain the next president the way it did, I think, with President Reagan, with President Clinton, and President George H.W. Bush.
Yeah, I think the casualty is not on China policy, but my fear is the casualty is going to be on trade policy. I am very worried about this idea that we will have to somehow renegotiate the TPP. I think that if we have to do that, it will be a huge blow to us in East Asia. These countries will not take it lightly if, after all they did to negotiate that agreement, we come back to them and say, well, I'm sorry, but, you know, because of the election, we're going to have to start this process all over again here. I also think that it makes it harder to do things like a bilateral investment treaty with China. All of these things, need congressional support, and the kinds of people who are getting elected this year in both the House and Senate, we'll see. But I worry that this will be the real casualty of this political period.
Okay. Let's give the audience a crack if you please. I think what I'm going to do, since I see a lot of hands, I'm going to take maybe three at a time, and then you guys can pick and choose what you want to do. So let's start here, here, and here. Let's start with you. And try to keep it tight. Okay?
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Okay. All right, we'll go the other direction.
Microphones are good.
Yeah, all right, so start there and then pass it.
Oh, thanks so much for the discussion today. Quick question. The events going on in Hong Kong, where we see the fundamental political fabric of Hong Kong changing in recent years, should we be concerned about that, or is Hong Kong still a strategic concern in the United States and what's going on there as well?
Two more.
So how strong is the recent Chinese commitment to addressing climate change? And is it coming from their independent volition, or is it their attempt to please us? And will that help with other countries like India that we still need to get on board?
One more.
How do you think the THAAD missile defense system will change U.S.-China relations? And do you see that as an obstacle in dealing with nuclear issues in North Korea?
There's a missile defense.
That's
THAAD. Oh, THAAD in South Korea. Okay. All right.
What's other thoughts? I think China's made a profound mistake in digging its heels against, you're familiar with the theater high altitude defense system. It's basically a very sophisticated radar that the U.S. is providing to South Korea so that they can get early warning detection and response in case of a North Korean missile launch. And the Chinese have reacted violently to it, basically mortgaged their whole relationship with South Korea, which they spent 25 years building up on the grounds that the THAAD system degrades China's deterrent, China's nuclear deterrent, that it will be used by the United States to detect Chinese launches vis-a-vis the U.S. Let's leave that aside for a moment. The notion that South Korea should be naked against North Korean missile and nuclear capabilities is a non-starter. No South Korean leader can accept that. And so for the Chinese to say, you shouldn't do this, you shouldn't do this, it shows a monumental insensitivity to the South Korean position. South Koreans could go nuclear. They could do nuclear power in a year, I'm sure. And they've chosen not to. The U.S. and the Chinese have been negotiating with the Chinese for a decade, and the North Korean nuclear program continues. What is South Korea supposed to do? So I think the Chinese position on this is frankly incomprehensible. And I think my own guess is that the Chinese are going to have to revisit it when two things happen. Number one, when President Park leaves office, which may be sooner than we had all expected. She was expected to leave office end of next year, but she's having problems that may mean it will be sooner. But let's assume for a moment she lasts till end of next year. And secondly, once the radar is up, which the expectation is be about the same time frame. So my guess is that once those two events occur, the Chinese will look at the situation and say, well, we have no more leverage. Let's get past this. That's my guess. But I think the Chinese position on this is, as I say, incomprehensible, self-destructive. I think we're doing the right thing, and I think South Koreans are doing the right thing.
Climate or Hong Kong? Or are you going to weigh in on that, too?
Well, I want to weigh in on North Korea. I'm going to leave Hong Kong to Jeff because I actually was a subordinate of Jeff's in Hong Kong, so he's far more capable of answering Hong Kong than I am. Let me just say a couple words on North Korea, because I do think that we haven't implemented our policy on the North Korean question well with the Chinese. I think the strategy is the right one. I don't think we can allow the North Koreans to become a nuclear power. I think statements that people are making about, well, this is inevitable, are really dangerous, because that leaves the door open to proliferation around the world, and we just can't accept that. And I don't think we can accept a nuclear North Korea, and we shouldn't. But what we haven't done is convince the Chinese that we're on the same page on North Korea. In other words, the Chinese still believe that what we want is a unified Korea under American control. I don't think that should be the American policy. I think we want a unified Korea at the end of the day under self-determination of the Korean people. I think the United States and China have got to find a way to have a strategic dialogue, much as Hank Paulson had a strategic economic dialogue, a strategic political dialogue on North Korea, which we have not been able to have. So what we do is we apply the sanctions and then China finds loopholes. And that isn't going to build the kind of pressure we need to build on the North Korean elites to get us to an agreement. So I think THAAD is actually a sub-topic of that same discussion. And if we had a strategic understanding, I'm not so sure THAAD would have become the problem it is. But that strategic understanding is missing on North Korea right now.
Hong Kong, just briefly, I think American news media coverage of Hong Kong is terrible. Every single article about Hong Kong in the U.S. press t- talks about one aspect of the Hong Kong issue, namely, is China complying with or not complying with the basic law governing Hong Kong? Is China eroding Hong Kong's freedoms? That's the only thing that we need to write about. Well, that's an important issue, okay? But that's not the only issue. And if you're in Hong Kong, what people in Hong Kong are aware of is the enormous alteration in their relationship with China economically over the last few decades. Hong Kong, as we all expected in 1997, is enormously integrated economically with China. It's not part of China economically, and Hong Kong depends on that, benefits from it substantially. That is just a reality that's not going away. Now, the Chinese have been very heavy-handed in their political treatment of Hong Kong. They are on decisions about whether or not the Legislative Council is going to be elected directly and freely, whether the next chief executive will be elected directly and freely. The Chinese have reacted, as Ben said, as communists. The Chinese clearly are concerned that if something resembling full-scale or substantial democracy comes to Hong Kong, how are you going to stop it at the border? Won't Guangdong say, gee, that looks pretty good to us? Okay, and I think that's the lens through which China views Hong Kong. They don't care so much about the political system in Hong Kong as such, except as a potential contagion to the mainland, which is unfortunate, but the reality of where the Chinese leadership is right now. Chinese heavy-handedness on the political side has created reactions in Hong Kong and created this independence movement, which I think is a fantasy, the notion of Hong Kong independent. Hong Kong is in Singapore. It's not 2,000 miles away. It's not going to become independent. And there is a strong sentiment against the Chinese political system and Chinese political pressure in Hong Kong, which the Chinese managed to reinforce by their behavior all the time. I don't see I guess the only thing I'd say about Hong Kong, it's interesting, if you look at those demonstrations over the last couple of years, if you're sitting in Beijing and you think about the future of Taiwan, Hong Kong seems like enough to have digested in the last 20 years, and the digestion has not been so easy politically. Is that something that you're ready for in Taiwan? I think the answer is no, that Hong Kong is enough of a challenge, and Taiwan with a completely separate political system, with a completely separate military, separate traditions, and 100 miles of water between Taiwan and the mainland, that would be a much, much, much more difficult challenge for China to absorb. So I think that the events in Hong Kong have probably slowed the train in terms of integration with Taiwan and Beijing's point of view.
Let me quickly on the climate change, because it was an important question. The simple answer is the agreement that China has signed is in China's interest. You go to Beijing today, and that air is pretty foul on many days in Beijing. The Chinese people are demanding that something happen on this issue. So I don't have doubts that the Chinese will move ahead on changing. In fact, I think they're moving ahead faster in some areas than we are. Now, one of them is because they're going to build 100 nuclear power plants. On the American side, we still have a debate in this country about nuclear power, but that will make a big difference in CO2 emissions, however you feel about nuclear power.
All right, let's get a few more questions. I got one in the back, one in the front, and then one more here. And then we'll do one more round.
I'm curious to know, when it comes to negotiations on any subject with China, I would assume that there are far more Chinese negotiators who are fluent in English that Americans who are fluent in Mandarin.
You got that.
In general. And does that, especially at the highest levels of government, does that pose a problem? And does the U.S. lose when it comes sometimes to understand slight variations in protocol and in mannerisms in dealing with the Chinese? And also quickly, is there any positive thing going on with trade between North Korea and China?
Okay, one more here. You mentioned that no serious American official wants to change the government or regime in China, and yet a fear that China seems to have a design in reshaping the rules of the global regime is to have a global regime that's safe for autocratic systems. And so this, I suggest, leads to an inevitable kind of conflict, and even a sort of paradox in that there's this idea of liberal peace. It's not that economic ties lead to peace, but it's that more liberal systems are more peaceful. So there seem to be several paradoxes that are adherent to policy.
Okay, one more here.
So much. So the president of Philippines is in the news recently. I was wondering if you could comment quickly on that, and more broadly, how has U.S. policy towards China impacted by the leadership and their and the policies of U.S.'s strategic partners bound by treaty commitments in China's geopolitical sphere? Thanks.
Well, yeah, the Philippines comes up at every event. Not just the Philippines, the president of the Philippines comes up at it. Let's do one more, just because I know time is short. So.
Kind of going off of China's allies in the region, South Korea got in the news recently because their Coast Guard fired on several Chinese vessels. What kind of does the escalation there of more like actual military tension lead to? Because usually it's just been kind of like standoffs, but at this point they're actually fighting. What kind of conflict does that lead to for U.S.-China relations in that area?
Can I broaden that question? So South Korea fishing,
yeah.
Japan, dual-lane patrols, Indonesia blowing up fishing, fishing. So don't make it just about South Korea, but more about operations and tensions with the neighbors. All right, so we got four now. This was more of a comment than a question, but liberal piece. And so who wants to jump in on it?
Let me try a quick shot at each. And liberal peace and sort of the Kantian notion of the international community. China's got a different system and different values. That's not going to change in my lifetime. I think probably anyone's lifetime. I think that we're going to have to find a more substantial and durable basis for international peace than the notion of universal values and liberal regimes around the world, because the Chinese have had and are going to have a different system for a long, long time to come. Sort of the Kantian ideals based on common values, really. And that's not where I think the world is heading. I mean, maybe they were, as Evan's very first question today alluded, maybe there were some illusions about that 20, 30 years ago when, as I said, the U.S. was a gatekeeper in international institutions. I think those illusions are substantially gone. Philippines, I got into trouble this morning answering a question, then the Philippine Consul General came up to me afterwards. Objected to what I said, so I'll repeat what I said. We are facing in the president of the Philippines, an unprecedented character in the Philippines, not unprecedented in international affairs. He doesn't look all that different from a number of people we've dealt with elsewhere in the world, like Chavez in Venezuela, or he's different from Castro in Cuba, but has a certain overlap, Mugabe in Zimbabwe. He's effectively ordered the murder of between 2,000 and 3,000 people. by his security forces on the basis that they were drug dealers. So he's shown a murderous streak. Despite his stopping his use of foul language for a weekend because he got a message from God, he's resumed cursing. And he calls, you know, he calls President Obama and the Pope and the American ambassador to the Philippines and everyone else I can think of, you know, dreadful names, and his rhetoric is hostile. He clearly has a chip on his shoulder about the United States. He has cultural, historical, racial resentment about the United States. He talks about the United States, and it's, I don't know, what's the phrase he uses? The U.S. believes in Philippines as little brown brothers, and the U.S. is sort of a white colonial overlord. I guess he missed 2008 when President Obama got elected. His hero and his political mentor was the head of the Philippine Communist Party. He's now in exile. So far as I'm concerned, he has clearly demonstrated ideological tendencies, thuggish tendencies, murderous tendencies, and anti-American tendencies. Underlying, right? The question is, so I don't think this is someone that the United States, frankly, can work with very effectively. I think that we have enormous people ties with the Philippines. The United States is more popular in the Philippines than the United States is popular in the United States. You see surveys in the Philippines and like 92% of Filipinos have a positive view of the United States, which is higher than the comparable figure in the United States. And so Filipinos love the United States. And the relationship between the Filipino and the American armed forces is long-standing, durable, intimate. There are major ties between the U.S. and the Philippines that I believe will survive the Duterte years. I think that the alliance can survive the Duterte years, but not through courting of Duterte. I think that is a waste of time. Now, I'm glad that he has reduced tensions with China. I think that the idea that the U.S. has a security commitment to Scarborough Shoal, to someone's sovereignty in Scarborough Shoal, or the U.S. should get into a conflict between the Philippines and China with Scarborough Shoal, to me that is a non-starter. And so the discussions between Duterte and Xi Jinping on that issue, I would say, have been constructive and helpful from the point of view of U.S. interests. Almost everything else Duterte has done has not been constructive from our perspective. Just very quickly on the other issues, I mean, North Korea-China trade, I'd be interested in what, I mean, Dennis would track this much more closely than I would. I would just say that, you know, what I would say on that is just two sentences, that North Korea is about, China is about North Korea's only trading partner right now, number one. And number two, there isn't much trade. The actual numbers are remarkably unimpressive. And the notion that China can, in my mind, that China can deliver North Korea, or that China has as much leverage over North Korea as people in Washington think, I think is wrong. Let's see. The issues on the sea, the Indonesian one, I think, has been very troubling. I mean, the Chinese, look, having Chinese gunboats around, you know, the Natuna Islands, I don't know, what is that? They're 1,200 miles from the Chinese coast and like 5 miles from Indonesia. The only basis for that I can think of is the nine-dash line. Chinese assertions that the nine-dash line gives them rights there and some sort of historical claims in the area.
More intimidation.
It's just, look, when I was with President Obama, I remember we met with President SBY, the predecessor of Jokowi. And he was profoundly disturbed over episodes with China. This was about 7 years ago. The Indonesians have been, you know, have been capturing Chinese vessels and burning them. I mean, this is just, I think, a sign of the expansiveness of Chinese claims in the South China Sea. The Koreans, they're, you know, look, back to fishermen, tough breed in every country in the world. These are tough people, okay? And so episodes between fishing vessels, that's got a long history in the East China Sea and South China Sea, and that's likely to continue. I think that the solution frankly, ought to be, they ought to forget about drawing lines in the South China Sea and this one say this one belongs to Brunei and this one belongs to Vietnam and this to Malaysia and this to China. I think they ought to just create an international commission for the South China Sea with all the six claimants. And they ought to just declare the whole South China Sea kind of an open fishing area with some sort of a commission to limit overall catch, maybe assign quotas. But the notion that you're going to draw a bunch of yellow lines on the map and say that, you know, Filipino vessels can go here and Malaysian vessels can go there, see, that's a non-starter. The fishermen would pay no attention to it anyway. I think that this, the ruling by the tribunal in The Hague, I think it's a terrific ruling. In essence, it said that no one has an exclusive economic zone anywhere in the South China Sea. That means no one's got more than a 12-mile limit around any feature. And that means basically it's an open sea in terms of fishing. And I think it would be great if the Chinese and others agree to that. They're obviously not in the short term. Last point, I don't know. Chinese English, yeah, I'd say that the number of Chinese officials who speak English well versus the number of American officials who speak Mandarin well, I'd say it's about a 10,000-to-1 ratio. happily for us now, English is sort of the universal language. Like French was the language of diplomacy in the 19th century. English is the language of diplomacy now. So a lot of the negotiations, I did WTO negotiations with the Chinese, my counterpart spoke perfect English. And so occasionally there'd be a formal session in Chinese, and I spoke Chinese and could understand Chinese, and it was certainly helpful in catching where the emphasis was and where the nuance was. But the major negotiations, a lot of them are in English, absolutely.
Any of these questions?
I think we'll just, I'll just add a little bit on the North Korea question. Look, the Chinese want to keep North Korea on life supports, okay? They do not want North Korea collapsed for the reasons I talked about earlier, that a unified peninsula they believe we would use against them. So they're in a dilemma. They know that they need to live up to their commitment on sanctions because they have agreed to these at the United Nations. On the other hand, they don't want to put so much pressure on North Korea that the regime comes down. So here's what we've seen. Certainly on North Korean proliferation, they've been very good recently. They have stopped the North both from acquiring equipment and sending equipment out. So I give them an A in that area. What they haven't been willing to do is we and they agreed at the UN on certain sanctions on things like coal. The Chinese have basically turned that agreement around in a way to give them the loophole to continue to buy coal from North Korea, giving the North Koreans money. Tony Blinken was just in Beijing, and Deputy Secretary of State Blinken was in Beijing trying to kind of close that loophole. But it's always going to be difficult if they don't believe in what we're trying to do here. So we're going to keep getting agreements, and they're going to keep sort of working the edges of those agreements because they don't want it to collapse.
Right, we're kind of at time, so I'm going to ask you one more thing, and then hope you can stick around and talk to some of the students. You're a student at the University of Chicago. You want to have a career in public policy. Mm-hmm. You want to be Jeff Bader or Dennis Wall. Or the Chinese version of Jeff Bader, Dennis Rose, and Sam Jackson. So what advice do you give to students who want to make a career out of this? How do you break in? How do you build a career?
I have a small bit of advice, and comes from the question asked before. I think that acquiring expertise and proficiency in Chinese and doing it at a young age is an enormous asset. I wish I had started before I was 35 years old in studying Chinese, by which time it's too late to acquire the kind of proficiency you should. But the opportunities in China, in diplomacy, in business, in NGO work, in education, are still huge despite recent problems, and they are really only available if you're Chinese. It's really, really good. So I mean, that's one thing I'd recommend.
Everybody wants to go to Washington and change the world. Or?
Well, there are a couple of things I would say, and I know this is trite, but I find it true. And some people say maybe we should alter this phrase. Find your passion in foreign policy. If there's something you really find absolutely fascinating, go for it. And the reason I say this is when I was in college in 1977, I decided I was going to do China. Well, there were no Chinese language programs. I had to take correspondence courses with the University of Michigan in order to do my Chinese. I then went to the Chinese University of Hong Kong to do more Chinese language study through the Yale and China program. I couldn't go into the mainland. While I was there, I started to read about the Chinese PLA, and I became absolutely fixated on the Chinese military. And so I wrote my senior thesis on the politics of the Chinese high command. I had no idea where this was going to take me, to be honest with you. And when I went to graduate school, I continued to work on the Chinese military. And one day I met a man named William Colby, former director of Central Intelligence. And he said to me, what are you going to do with your life? And I said, well, I don't know, join the State Department, maybe join a bank. He said, wrong answer. And he took me to this place across the Potomac with a lot of high security around it. And I could never find the way to the exit from that place. But my point is, find something that grabs you and then pursue it. And the job will come. Because if you're good at what you do, the rest falls into place.
Well, you came, we picked an interesting day for you to come to Chicago. The city is gridlocked with the Cubs. But this is the south side of Chicago. This is White Sox country.
Thank you.
There we go. I'm a Cubs fan, but okay. So anyway, I hope you can stick around and talk to some of the students. But everyone, please join me. Thank you.